Okay, so we're rolling.
Yes, we're rolling. Definitely rolling.
Wow. Okay. Okay.
Back again in the full team. The last time was without Maki, as you said. Last time we filmed at Melt. Yeah. And it was a little bit of a different vibe. But I enjoyed it. It was easy. What do you think?
Yeah, I feel like a lot of the engagement as well had been specifically around the topics covered on that session. Well, the festival part anyway.
Yeah.
Rather than the kind of ongoing bigger topics that we discussed maybe.
Mm-hmm.
And on that note, we have our first guest today. Dear friend of mine, dear friend of Drift also, Iza. We met in Kiev just over 2 years ago.
Yeah.
At this place, in fact.
Yes.
what is it? Is it the one that doesn't exist?
It's the one that allegedly still doesn't.
Nice.
Allegedly still doesn't, for those that
ongoing, not existing.
Exactly, exactly. Nice. As intended. and yeah, 2 years later, beautiful international friendship. We have the pleasure, honor, privilege to invite Iza to be our first guest.
Welcome.
The honor is all mine.
Not true, but we can share. We can share.
Giving tough love from the first second.
Yeah, exactly.
50-50.
Let's agree.
Yeah, yeah. So Iza, please tell us about yourself. Tell us who you are.
I'm Izabelle, from Amsterdam. Not born and raised in Amsterdam, but and I first I'm a raver.
Nice.
That's how it started. And
raver by definition.
Yeah. Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. And the rest will, I think, when we talk, will
yes.
Yeah.
Will unfold.
Yeah.
There's a lot of stuff that we already know about you. I hope to find out a little bit more today, but we can just go through the big topics or. I don't know how to say it. Yeah, themes. First of all, you're a member of the Night Board of Amsterdam.
Yes.
So tell us first, us or the viewers, what is the Night Board of Amsterdam?
So in Amsterdam, we have a night mayor, and then there is the night board, and that's actually an advice board. There are a couple of people in the board, and they have they all have their specialties. I share my seat with Fred from Orvik. Orvik is a collective in Amsterdam, and they're doing great work. So I'm really proud to share this seat with Fred from Orvik.
Nice. What do you mean you share a seat?
Because normally you have, there is one person who, how do you say that, represent a part of the scene. So we have someone that is there who is chairwoman of the festival board. They represent festivals. We have someone from that represent all the clubs in Amsterdam. And Fred and I are there. Actually, it's also an honor because there were never organizations that organized on the ground raves in the board. And I think Amsterdam saw that it was actually needed to have those in the board as well. Mm-hmm. So we give advice, equality, diversity, and me as a feminist and a woman.
And you advise the nightmare. And who is the nightmare?
The nightmare is Freek.
Nightmare is what? A freak, did you say?
Freek. No, it's typical.
He's a nightmare.
Actually, it's funny because he's, or not funny, but he's from Jewish background. Yeah.
Well,
it's a nice,
we're all freaks.
Yeah. His name is Freek. A lovely person. Yeah.
Nice,
Just chosen because after the pandemic, or during the pandemic, actually, the new nightmare should have been chosen, but then...
Was there a nightmare before the pandemic?
Yes.
Okay.
That was Shamiro.
And...
you all know him as well, living in Berlin now.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you know Shamiro?
I don't know. Okay. No, never heard of the person. And these are, as you said before, persons that are being chosen or like being elected?
We are not elected.
Okay.
We were put together.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Who and, put you together?
And but actually, it is funny because we are really talking now how we are going to pass it forward, and how long are we going to be there?
Yes.
So that is something that Fred and I are really investing.
And sorry, how long have you been in this capacity?
For a couple of months now.
Mm. Okay.
And do you, I mean, could you do it indefinitely? Would you want to do it indefinitely?
If there's because that would not be, that would not be, I don't know, I wouldn't say fair. I think it things evolve and I would pass my knowledge to someone else and...
Any position of power or political position, but, it's still a political position.
Yeah.
If you kind of possess it for too long, there is the danger of completely like losing the sense of it.
Yeah.
So yes, it definitely has to be defined how long they.
I'm just gonna lean this way a bit so I can see you because I can't. I'm missing the.
It's a little bit industrial having all this metal in our faces.
It looks like these are your arms.
I'm just holding my arms.
Yeah.
Cool. I was in Poland at an old wharf, and the cranes, they look like this.
Nice. Yeah. So you visited Poland. How was it for you? You visited only Warsaw or some other places?
No, also Gdansk and Gdynia.
Gdansk.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
And what do you think? Your first time in Poland?
It was my first time.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool.
I drove once through Poland
to the
border, actually, to Hungary. But it was my first time and loving it.
Yeah.
Loved it. Yeah,
surprising.
Still a bit in recovering.
I'll ask what comes to my mind first. How's the music?
I really enjoyed. But maybe I have to tell also I am a part of Radion, a club in Amsterdam.
Yes.
And I do marketing communication.
Yes.
And I come up with new concepts. And lately I'm investigating Gen Z and the new generation.
Mm-hmm. Investigating. I like this word.
Yeah, investigating.
The whole generation.
Mm-hmm. The whole generation.
Gen Rave, Z, Gen Rave. Z, you're under investigation. Isa is going to find out.
I'm on TikTok. As of my year.
But not under your real name.
Not under my real name also.
This is how we got into TikTok. We started as voyeurs and then
you
get
the dance.
Into it.
That's how you get into everything, Ben.
Yeah. That's how you get into KitKat. Cool.
Ouch.
We always have to bring KitKat at least for 1 second into the episode.
Yeah.
It will either help the videos go popular or just break the ice.
Yeah, it's not been an uproar so far. They've had bigger fish to fry.
Yeah, I agree. So Poland, special experience, the music you liked. I'm asking about the music because we started working with some very talented Polish artists over the last couple of years. A good friend of ours, as I told you, is moving from Berlin to Warsaw and is telling us very interesting things about Warsaw. And I would love to visit. We were in Warsaw 2 years ago, but we haven't been to a proper club like Jasno or Smolna. And we would love to go, and I'm glad to hear it was
good. Yeah, it's actually a friend of ours, MKO, works for Jasna. Unfortunately, he was not there. There was another friend, Kuba, who was playing.
Nice.
And Kuba is actually, Jakub, is actually playing exactly what Gen Z wants. And
okay.
I was pleasantly surprised.
And how would you define exactly what Gen Z wants?
Actually, that's a beautiful question because I don't think Gen Z wants one or two things. They love eclectic things.
Yes.
Or three things. They want
to scroll through the music fast.
Fast.
Yes.
With high BPM. They love to recognize things. So it's either hyperpop or new trends or old school gabber combined.
So TikTok.
Hyperpop. Yeah. Hyperpop. I didn't hear this phrase.
Really?
Hyperpop is a thing.
It's one of the biggest things ever. There was
one of
this,
the biggest things ever.
Yeah.
Ever.
Ever.
What was the name? I'm sorry. I always forget the artist name of this trans artist that died a couple of years ago, and she was huge.
She, I forgot her name. Sophie.
Sophie. Yes.
Sophie.
Then I was exposed through Sophie. I was exposed to hyperpop, and I was amazed. Actually, like the production of the music is something almost alien-y.
Yeah.
You know, it's just super sweet and soft, and at the same time powerful and hard. This is like,
and
this
it could be Britney Spears, and it's and it is also
Britney
political.
Spears on steroids because, with a yeah. smart production.
Yeah. I mean, I'm intrigued.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, and, yes. And actually, I must say, maybe 5 years ago, I would run out of a club.
Yes.
And now I was dancing to Bailando, Bailando.
Uh-oh.
I kid you not.
This reminds me of Nina Kravitz and. And this is a forbidden song right now.
Which song? Which song?
Because Nina Kravitz came out with it a couple of weeks ago.
With the Bailando Bailando track?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. She just sang the song, the same song from the 90s, and brought it out as her own track right now. And
we don't mention her name here. No. You don't. Pandora doesn't go back in the box.
Well, it's okay. It's okay.
Send me a set of Britney Spears on steroids.
Yes.
And I will.
I can send you some nice hyperpop. We have in Amsterdam. We have Jan Tekna.
Yes, some Amsterdam
Tekna?
Hyperpop.
Jan
hyperpop.
Tekna. Jan Tekna.
Tekna.
Nice. Cool.
I would love to introduce them to to the Berlin scene. Because I think
you should, because I will give a little bit of tough love of my own experience. I was very intrigued by hyperpop or by just what Gen Z is now listening to. And I went to a party in Panorama Bar. I always tell about that one party of Life from Earth in Panorama Bar where Horse Girl was playing, and she was playing 175 BPM. And I was just intrigued and interested. But after 15 minutes, I was bored. And
because it was repetitive?
No, because it was too simple. It was not too fast. It's not that I want to be that old guy that says, "Oh, I love high BPMs when they're."
I am.
I mean, when the high BPMs are explainable, when there is a certain logic to fast transitions, to usage of bangers and so on. If you jump from Justin Timberlake to Britney Spears to Destiny's Child, it's okay. But it has to be technically good. The sound production has to sound good. But there are some artists, again, I just mentioned a name, I can mention another, it doesn't matter. Some artists don't give a fuck anymore. And there is this whole vibe of not giving a fuck. And just, we talk about this mediocreness for some time already. This is something that bothers me very much. Technical mediocrity, and this doesn't help hyperpop, because hyperpop has some humor in it, some unseriousness, but I think the technical skill and the quality of the production should still stay there, you know? I think that the new generation is just, they want to have all the knowledge and just spit out something that is super simple and fun and happy, you know?
But when soap showers start, I think that's how they start.
When what starts, sorry?
Soap showers. Yeah, so for example, Gabber and also you were talking in a previous podcast about all the soap showers that came out. Soap showers.
Sorry, I didn't. Sub-genre.
You heard soap showers. He always thinks about Ibiza parties with soap showers.
I heard soap shower, and then I assumed it was. Is an accent, and she was saying soap shower.
I thought Gaba parties are like soap and showers.
You have those.
Phone parties.
And you know what? Like as a 17-year-old in Magaluf, which I have been, these are dope. But then you get it on your skin and eyes, and it is not so dope.
No. I haven't done this experience.
But yeah, I mean, it's not something I would pair with an electronic music rave.
Yeah.
That's for sure.
Yeah, yeah.
But that's, there we go again. So I think that, I speak to Gen Z. What they want is not too complicated. They want light and they want fun. That's that's how they say it. And I do think that technical wise, they will become better. It's a new genre. Yes. It's new. I'm also the booker of cybersex, for example, and cybersex is different because they have a different background, and you can see the difference. But they are more house and then fast tempo. They're not a hyperpop. But I think the quality will become better.
Yes,
it's brand new.
I think it's a huge skill for an artist in electronic music or in any kind of art to create a product that has a complex production process but still served as a very simple dish.
Yeah.
You know, this is, I think, art.
Yeah.
You know, and if you just serve something that you just spit, I think some will like it to a certain extent, but at the end, it doesn't last long.
Yeah, but that's also something that we need to see how long this will, how long it will last. I predict long.
Yeah.
Why?
Because of more than 30 years of experience. Some things I predicted wrong, though, but I think this will last longer. It's a very dark world, and
they need the contrast. Okay. They need the contrast.
That's what I meant when I said.
And
why,
I also think the way we consume is also not the way Gen Z wants to consume. They're very conscious about, oh, I'm going to a party, but I have school. Maybe I only go to one party. They don't have the FOMO thing anymore.
You think they're
like
more responsible?
They're way more responsible.
Because they know more?
Maybe they know more, or they use now to social media. The millennials were a generation that were struggling with it, had mental illnesses because some people went to 3 parties and they only went to 1.
Yeah.
And I think for Gen Z, it's more natural, the whole...
Millennials still had the side effects of end of the 90s ecstasy.
Yes. Yeah.
And they were still like glowing.
Some of them still do. Some of them still do. Some of them still do.
No, and I think they went on the opposite. So I think that generation were in an immediate effect of, for example, the wall coming down.
Mm-hmm.
The need to party.
The anarchist punk movement that actually woke the techno here in Germany, probably.
Yeah.
And
well, I mean, in Berlin, definitely. Yes. I put like the early 90s was the birth of the European scene in that sense.
Yes, yes. So they needed to get dirty. And now what you say is that they want to be fun, they want to be positive, to give themselves a different mirror picture of reality. Because we have the pandemic, we have the war, we have everything going on.
Yeah,
at the
and
same
it's
time.
Not the end. Global warming.
Yeah, it's probably not the end.
Yeah, yeah.
So you think that the worse it gets, the more replaced this hyper pop will have as a subgenre.
It's not what we did, but I think with us maybe the things were more positive or in the end.
Maybe just less apocalyptic.
Yeah. And maybe after a pandemic, it's like, oh my God, this could be the end.
Yeah.
Let's put Britney Spears on a very high BPM.
So, a dear friend of mine said to me about his view on humanity at the moment. We are in humanity's closing set, so let's just enjoy the ride, which is kind of beautifully.
That explains today's music, to be honest. It's like sunrise, it's a jumpy, happy, and not overthinking too much.
There you go. Well, I mean, which also summarizes a lot of Gen Z in some sense.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
And you can see it also in Berlin, parties like Multisex, also the way they handle their marketing.
Yeah.
But they're doing great.
Yes. It's interesting that you mentioned them. I want to hear more of your opinion of Multisex.
That's difficult for me because I've never been. I was supposed to go, but then I ended up 29 hours in Berghain.
Just
it's like
I mean,
it happens.
No, it's really normal. Yeah.
I love that you said at the start. Primarily, I'm a raver, and he said, oh, you'll get to know more about me throughout this conversation. Just like, oh, I just spontaned, you know, Neunen Swinses Schunden in Berghain. Yeah. Happens.
No, but it was really after the pandemic, after a long time, it was my best Berghain session. It was the night that Olivia Mendez, Inox Trax, Filipa Pacho, and Yako ended.
Love Inox Trax.
Yes.
Love Inox Trax.
Yeah. Yes. But four women having those slots, it hits different.
Mm.
I could not stop dancing.
Yeah? Was emotional?
Emotional, but also very happy. It was it was light.
Yeah.
Hyperpop?
Well, actually, they... it's not hyperpop, but you can, and I think a lot of DJs do it now in Berghain, that you hear more vocals, more house based tracks. So I see that also a lot of techno DJs.
Yeah,
not just Berghain in general.
In general.
It's more popular. I mean, you look at the kind of, let's say Trim and MRD and this kind of sound. You know, this is a lot bigger now. Also,
yeah. And I actually enjoy it. And if you would have spoken
would you liken this kind of style that I just mentioned to hyperpop in terms of the vibe or the kind of like inherent nostalgia being, do you know what I mean? Like to hyperpop, it's like a more.
It's recognizable because there were hits from the 90s and the zeros. Mm. Is that what you mean?
I understand more now because I like it could be more like this kind of style, you know, which like so let's say DJ Heartstring.
Yeah.
DJ Heartstring is not necessarily playing stuff from the 90s. It just sounds like it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. And is it like inspired by?
Sure. Yeah. Exactly. This kind of like nostalgic teen flavor kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
You have a lot of artists taking a specific aesthetic from the past and bringing it into the future. Yeah. You have Brutalism 3000. Yeah. You have Curses.
I adore them, by the way.
They're super nice. Yeah, yeah, the whole concept is very nice. They also they call themselves post-techno and more pop, actually, than techno. Yeah. And we have a very nice example.
Post-techno. Yeah, they think techno is also a bit pretentious, which I maybe agree with them.
Which is... pretentiousness in the techno scene is unfortunately real.
Yeah.
Yes.
Which is also, and disclaimer, I also have not been there, so this is not my opinion, it's just what I've heard. Yeah. You mentioned multisex. I hear good things about the vibe and the party, but bad things about the attitude of some of the crowd in like, this is for pretty people.
Yeah.
This kind of.
This is the sentence we hear the most.
But that's actually like to make a little bridge. I'm also part of the collective.
I'm also pretty.
Not at all. But I'm also part of the collective Eerste Communie. And if people never been to your party, they would always say shitty things, especially when they got refused.
Yes.
A lot of my friends go to multisex, and I only hear positive things about multisex. Nice. But I can't have any judgment because I've never been.
I think I know only like musically what they aim for, and I think the sound that they aim for is just very pleasant.
Yeah.
And this is why it's hard to go in there, take a look at the beautiful people and hear just nice sounds, even poppy sounds, and to say something bad about it. So I think in general, they're creating something just positive, you know? I don't think they have any hard going vibes there. And also the locations that they pick right now, it's Watergate, it's Weekend. Weekend is a club that has been a poppy club for years in Berlin. That's where they're doing their next party. So I think they understand what they're doing.
Yeah.
Definitely. Yeah. Cool. So we've talked about the night board of Amsterdam. Maybe we can come back to that topic. I'm really interested in asking some questions regarding the board and its responsibilities or the difficulties or the challenges that you might have there. You mentioned also Radion.
Yeah.
You are the booker of Radion.
Not the booker. I'm marketing communication.
Marketing and communication.
Yeah, and communication.
Okay. So
he is the booker. And I will give him some advice.
maybe she gives a couple of suggestions.
Sometimes he asks for it, and sometimes I just give advice.
Yeah, sometimes the suggestions are stronger than others, as we might.
Sometimes advice is needed.
I'm very stubborn,
nice.
But I know what I'm doing.
Okay.
Yeah, it's
plus one.
If I put my foot down, it's definitely for a reason.
How?
Either creative-wise or political, but it's always it has a reason.
Sometimes both. Yeah.
And sometimes both.
How long have you been in Radion now?
A little bit over 2 years.
And how long does the club exist?
9 years, yeah.
9 years, yeah. Okay, cool. Yeah. And how is it for you there? How is the platform called Radion? Is it does it wear different skins, or it has its own identity? Is it more of a platform or really a club, as I said, with a known identity? How do you define
it? Nice question.
It's definitely a club.
Yes.
But I think they've grown. I think Radion has had a different identity before the pandemic. And I think Radion now has a very strong identity. It's definitely a techno club. We do have some external parties from the past that are so connected to Radion that we still provide a place for them. We're always looking for new young promoters. We're, I think, one of the only clubs who are very open to new promoters. They can make mistakes and we guide them, we help them. And we love also to work with promoters from abroad. For example, Drift.
How was Drift and Radion?
How was Drift? I mean, thank you to everyone that came. Firstly, you know how it was. Crazy. Like, beyond anything we anticipated, for sure. There was a little bit of mild panic with the lack of pre-sales. But ausverkauft on the night. And you know what? The crowd was insane. It was a mix. So obviously, like, JP, Oller and I had networked pretty hard when we came for Freddie K all night long last June. We have a lot of good friends in the scene, and every single person we invited either said, sorry, I can't make it, or I'll be there. And so we already had this immediate network of people who knew what to expect and came for the right reasons and came with love and rolled out the red carpet for us, I can say, but in a non-pretentious way. Then I can say people that Radion regulars, you know, people that came for a specific DJ on a very awesome lineup, and the Ukrainian contingent came out of the woodwork. Dozens. People, Slava Ukraini. people who I hadn't seen since maybe in Kiev a couple of years ago, and they're living in Amsterdam now.
Some you didn't even recognize.
So, talking about Vlad. Yes, Vlad. Yeah. you see. Yeah, so like, people I knew from K41, people I knew from Drift in Kiev, coming in Amsterdam and saying thank you for this safe space and having a backstage that felt like it wasn't in Amsterdam because it was all us, you know. But also with new friends. So it was amazing. The music was incredible from start to finish in both rooms. And to be able to say that and be proud of this and to have the response of actually who the fuck are Drift, actually. And yeah, I mean, stay tuned.
No, but you are very popular in Amsterdam. People know about Drift.
I don't have that. Well, thank you for coming also then, and we'll be back.
Nice to hear.
And yeah, obviously thank you to Iza for the trust and opportunity. She put both feet down for us, you know. And you know, it was absolute pleasure.
I'm intrigued.
Next week you have to be there.
I'll do my best. I've been to Amsterdam a couple of times, and I never been clubbing in Amsterdam. I was always super touristic. It was a very young age, but I've been a couple of times only, like,
for coffee shops.
Weeding cookies.
So much more.
I mean, look, like, I've been to Amsterdam now about 12 times. And the first
12,
approximately.
Wow.
Most of this was between the age of 19 and 24, when I was going for coffee shops, maybe truffles, you know, if it's summer, you know.
Risky.
Whiskey. Risky. Whiskey. No. Nick these them up. I did party once in the Netherlands as a younger man, which was in Rotterdam, at, begins with P. Perron, maybe?
Perron,
Yeah. And that was my first ever techno rave, actually.
Oh, wow.
At the time, I wasn't impressed.
No.
Not, but just because I was so accustomed to raving being drum and bass, much higher BPM, different energy. I was just like, this, like,
boring.
Where's the actual music? Is this like, because it felt very...
Felt like lounge.
It felt like queuing for the roller coaster indefinitely.
Just queuing. Yeah.
Queuing
at 140 BPM.
Just queuing.
Almost like Berghain, just queuing. The Berghain experience today is just queuing.
For some people, it is.
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
Literally.
I mean, if you're not a
Schlanger. No Schlanger, wieder.
Nein.
Yeah. Yeah. Vielleicht heute ist mein Tag. Classic.
Yeah.
But you can always try it again. I was once refused. You were refused? Yeah, once. And then Gils, my partner of Eerste Communie and Kromanti.
Partner in crime.
My partner in crime. And Pichera, we do a lot together. He had to give me his key of the house. He looked at me and he said, "Go home, change. And I don't mean your clothing, but your fucking attitude."
Who said that?
Gils to me. And then I did. I went home.
My energy was low.
And that's also something.
You go home and you fix that attitude.
So I did. And it's a beautiful story because it was the 13-hour closing of Freddie K on his birthday. So can you imagine if I would have missed that?
Wait, no. Which year?
17, the big breakthrough, the legendary closing.
Before you came to
that's
Berlin.
Before I came to Berlin. Yeah.
Legendary closing.
The 5 p.m. Yeah. The 5 p.m.
I have a picture because I had to take my shoes off. I take my shoes off very often in Bergheim, by the way. But
risky.
I'm fuck here. And then I made a picture because I had blisters all over, I was really proud of them.
Wow. Yeah. 2017, Freddie K closing.
Yeah.
And you stayed till the end?
Almost.
And it was 5 p.m., right?
I don't know what time it was. I never check.
It's like bad for your mental health. The legendary
closing. Was it until 5?
It was like 18 hours or something like this. Yeah. My longest Freddie K closing was 13 hours, I believe. And that was definitely top 3 sets of my life. Yeah. Well. Shout out to Alessio. Thank you for K-Vine or Elsa. Yeah. That was a great
shout out to Gils as well for bringing up the attitude.
Yeah.
We actually, me and Gils, we were at the same time in Kiev for many times, but we met in Berlin through a common friend.
Yeah.
But we had really a lot of common friends in Kiev, and it was really heartwarming to catch up together. I think it was when it was before the war, and he's now in Berlin, right?
He moved to Berlin in 2016.
A while ago.
Yeah,
2016.
Yeah.
Actually, you just came to the very first drift ever.
I know.
The very first drift ever.
The thing is, I was in Kiev, but I was.
You don't
destroyed.
Have to. No one's pointing a finger saying where the fuck were you?
No, I feel really sorry that I.
You were
didn't.
In Kiev and you didn't come. See, I didn't even know you were in Kiev until now. Now it's even worse. That was just like.
Nice. So let's come back to maybe Ask the Communier, because we already went briefly through the Nightboard and Radion, and tell us shortly, what is Ask the Communier?
Ask the Communier is a collective. We're with 5. Maron, it was actually really funny, the question that you asked, how was the set of Maron in Kiev? that's when we met.
Yeah.
We talked about it.
Yeah.
And then it's March 2021.
Yeah. And then Gils and
front left. Corner links.
Typisch
Izzo.
Yeah. In Bergheim, it's not front left, and that's.
In Bergheim, it was front left.
Yeah.
Apparently that was back right.
Yeah.
That's what I hear. I hear the action happens back right these days.
Okay. Can I check?
Can you check?
Yeah.
I mean, be my guest.
Yeah, okay.
I'm not checking.
I lost you both like 5 minutes ago. I have no idea.
Because I'm curious.
You see, Ben doesn't see corners. He sees one big shape. He just goes in like a swan.
No, it's
in Bergheim, I always use the niche on the right. I go to the bar, to the back, next to the DJ. Everybody says that's the promoter corner, bro.
It is the promoter corner.
You know what?
It is. I'm a promoter now.
The thing is, I like to have space when I dance. Yeah. I need space. I'm also pretty big, so I go into the niche and nobody bothers me there. The sounds echoes through the stone wall, and I feel like part of the crowd, but still separated from it. So that's why.
I try always VIPing. Be in front of the
I need a fence and a bottle of champagne, and then we can call Berka in the weekend.
Champagne campaign. Yeah.
No, just kidding. Yeah. So you said something about back
wait,
right.
Wait, did you ever pop a bottle of champagne in Bergheim?
No. Should I?
I don't know. I think I would feel very awkward if someone popped a champagne and poured me a flute. You know, I'd be like, Prost. I think.
What? Straight from the bottle.
Straight from the bottle. if someone offered me a swig, I would take it.
Yeah.
I would take it.
Yeah, why not? Yeah, my fanciest border is at espresso martini and maybe some other cocktails. So sometimes I ask them to do something fancy, but no, I cannot imagine drinking something from the bottle and back.
No.
I don't know. But I do like Panorama Bar for being a proper bar.
Yeah.
This is something that pisses me off in other clubs in Berlin. Almost not one club in Berlin has a proper bar where you come and you can see just different drinks and just order some classics. You know, it doesn't have to be fancy. I don't like fancy cocktails, but, you know, just professional bartenders, nice alcohol, nice or a menu. And, you know, yeah. I come to Trésor, which I really like. I think Trésor is an institution, will always be. But then I come to the bar and it looks like, I call it a bar mitzvah bar because you have like three drinks to choose from. You know, it's like something organized by a like a family event or something.
Is it typical to have three drink choice at a bar mitzvah?
Yeah, normally you do.
is that a thing?
Beer, wine and soft drinks.
Yeah. You have like cola, whiskey.
We call it the Dutch bar, by the way.
It's not a bar mitzvah menu.
We call that a Dutch bar.
A Dutch bar, you call it? The Dutch are very similar to the Jews. They're all merchants.
Only at bar mitzvahs.
Yeah, so I always also, I complain about the mediocrity of Berlin's gastronomy and blah, blah. And I think the clubs are part of Berlin's gastronomy. And they all suffer from a really mediocre planning or construction of, how would I say, service or... I like to spend my time nicely at a club. This is something that, for example, in K41 was always like this feeling of pleasure. We came into the club, there is one bar that serves you this, one bar that serves you that, something else, some food, some, and you always feel that the staff is really taking care of you. They always try to see if you're good and if you're happy with it, if it's tasty for you, something that you probably don't feel even at Berghain, where the bar is like the most professional, but still they give you a don't give a fuck attitude.
I feel like what you're describing wouldn't be utilized or appreciated by enough people in this environment.
But you know, I also like a bit of, because sometimes I'm complaining it's too warm, but can you imagine a rave where it's too cold?
If it's airy? You know?
Airy, yeah. But I think the suffering face, you know? Being in line for the toilets for 2 hours to get a bomb, I think that's the suffering is also part of the experience.
Yes, I do agree that the reward...
You have to earn it. You have to really want it. Yeah.
It's part of the quest. It's your reward at the end that waits for you. But after, like, after... raving for a while, after doing this for a while, you just want a small portion of fun and then just go home, have a good sleep, you know? You don't want to go through the whole process. But you still
do
don't
you think you're speaking for Gen Z?
Probably not. I think Gen Z should go through some suffering. Okay. I think, you know what I believe in?
I agree, actually.
I'm kidding about the suffering because I think we all do have a collective consciousness.
Yeah.
That's why I think Gen Z has to be faster than us. They have to learn faster and know faster and somehow...
Yeah, otherwise they're going to drown.
Yes.
Yeah.
We are also responsible for that. Yeah. We are responsible for passing on the information in a compatible way for them. Kind of, I call it remixing correctly. If we serve them the right remix, they would know about the right music from the past. Yeah.
You've got to be a good DJ, producer.
That's actually... funny that you mentioned it. I interviewed, so during ADA, we have our own concept on the Friday. It's called LNR, which is it's short of local night Radion. And we curated
LNR.
LNR.
This is one of the conflict regions right now between Russia and Ukraine. Yeah, okay. Just something for the protocol. Some positive news for the protocol.
Local night Radion, let's call it that.
Yes.
So we have Amoral, Maron, Cristal, Delano Legito, Beste Hira. So
I love all these guys.
So it's a proper cyber sex. Karina Schneider. I can go on and on and on.
Techno Slave.
I only know also, Radio Slave. I don't know. Techno Slave
is amazing.
Yeah. Techno Slave did
Drift.
A spectacular closing for Drift at Radion. It was
as packed
as Freddie K's closing. Yeah. Well, it was as really. Packed. It he was is. As packed.
He's a resident of Radion.
You can call it that. Yes. We don't work with residents, but he's definitely a regular.
A regular.
As a raver and as a DJ.
Nice.
Not his first rodeo.
Yeah.
But I did an interview with all of them, and basically all of them started out at very commercial parties. Hmm? Their first parties were, I'm not going to mention any names, but
I was just about to say, can you tell us some?
Very commercial. And then they start to enjoy the music, and then someone brings them to another party, and then to another party, and then it's like, I want to know more. Mm. And then they're going to investigate. Mm-hmm. And then they will find the Freddy K's and the Redheads and the Devious Ones.
I would say there's only one Freddy K. But yeah.
Although Gen Z, they have no idea. They don't know all these names.
Yes. I had some incidents where I was like mentioning names, but also not only DJs or artists of electronic music, also just you know, pretty big famous musicians or bands which they know nothing about.
Nirvana, they know.
Nirvana, they know. Yeah. Also probably through a TikTok mix.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, I think this is something that we are missing. Our generation is missing a big responsibility, and also the older artists and DJs, they kind of let go of this generation and keep doing what they're doing instead of finding a way of communicating.
That's you know? Precise. And also they had monopoly for a very, 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 very long time. It was almost impossible for young talent if you didn't had your network or connections to even become someone. As a promoter in Holland, you had no chance.
Oh, wow.
No chance. So I'm very happy that that changed. I'm fighting very hard for it.
How did you think that changed? Promoters can just come up now and prove themselves?
Yeah.
Without having a previous network, just by having a good product? Or
Network is... without network, I don't think things are possible.
Yes.
But I think people like EC and me, we are very present.
Yes.
So we visit, we talk. Orphic is a very important player. Because Orphic, I always call Orphic the glue. They are here to connect. Mm-hmm. So beside parties, they do DJ nights where they invite younger but also established
like new faces in Trezor, for example. Yeah. They have every Wednesday like new faces.
Yeah, but this is really like a drink, a beer, and talk to each other.
Not a commercial event.
No. It's really in a studio.
Community
event.
And it happens in Radion.
No, it happens in the same building, but at the FIG. That's another story. Nice. The provider of the elite rave equipment.
So there's multiple venues within the Radion complex.
Yeah, it's the complex is called ACTA, and you have student housing, Radion, and a lot of studios. Creative.
Didn't realize it was so big because you kind of come straight to Radion from the road. I didn't know there was more stuff behind it.
Maybe a direct question. Is it all supported by private funds, or is there support from the state for a complex like that?
No.
It's all private.
It's all private.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. It's just nice that something like that.
I think there is only one, I think Garage Noord.
Which is where you regularly do Eerste, right?
Where we did Eerste Communie. Yeah, lovely place. But for the rest, it's all commercial. Yeah.
Let's come back to Eerste Communie. You said you are a collective of five.
Yeah.
So it's you?
It's me. It's Skills. It's Maron. It's Desmond and Diederik.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the five of us. Yeah.
How did you guys meet?
So I was working in what was a very underground place in the 80s, 90s, in the supper club. And the supper club became very commercial, a lot of tourists, a lot of parties with bottle service. Mm. So
it was too good not to become commercial? Was it just
I think
the
they are already there for 35 years. Uh-huh. So then you have to.
Yeah.
You can't blame them.
Yeah.
And so I got the chance to do a party there, which was on a Sunday called Kerk Church.
Called what?
Yeah.
Kerk Church.
Kerk, it means church. Yeah. And Desmond was working with me, and I told him about this concept. He was very impressed. And then he said, I have a couple of friends. They're really into techno. You should meet them. So I met them. And so in the beginning, I was not part of Eerste Communie, but always supporting. That's also where I met Ines. I think he was 16 or 17 years old. Yeah. And it's full circle. So EC was already working for Radion. He was talking to the boys of Eerste Communie, and then they were not big enough. So he basically said, you should go into the illegal rave scene. Mm. So the first illegal rave I visit to support.
What does that mean by definition, illegal rave?
Exactly that. It's illegal. You find a spot.
It means you just don't announce it nowhere. It's a spot that is normally not used for partying. Yes, you just build it up at the same day.
Yeah. Okay. And it could be that you have to move a couple of times when police catch.
Yeah, you said in our previous conversation that illegal raves in Amsterdam or in Holland are acceptable by the police. They are kind of accepted by the authorities.
Everything in Holland that is a bit illegal. There is a word in German for it, but I always forget. But we in Holland call it gedoogbeleid, and that's actually when you do like this. So it's not allowed to grow weed, but it's allowed to sell it. And it's the same with, it's not allowed to do illegal raves. And it also depends which police officer.
Understand that.
Yeah.
Understand that.
So it's definitely not allowed. It's very illegal. That's why it's called illegal rave. And a lot of times we find places that.
What's the worst thing that could happen to an organizer of an illegal? A big fine. But no jailing.
I even have a record right now.
Okay. Yeah.
Nice. And they confiscate equipment, I guess.
Yeah, but the equipment is never ours, so the owner can eventually get it back.
And that's a loophole that you
that's
found.
That's a loophole.
Nice. Good to find the loopholes.
And you always have to agree when you join a legal party which person will now go to the police and take the blame. And in that period, for all of the Eerste Communie team, it was not possible to have a record. Mm-hmm. And for me, it's fine. I'm already established.
You're a raver.
So I have a record, yeah, an official one.
So, like, I know from personal experience, there were ongoing illegal raves even throughout the COVID period. I feel like the COVID period is when Eerste Communie really went from underground through to massive.
Yeah.
Was that you were doing a lot of parties in this time also?
No, actually we exploded right before the pandemic. Our Instagram went viral because of a video.
Under the bridge.
Yeah.
with Kobe.
yeah. With Kobe of a day. Exactly.
Classic.
And then the pandemic happened. So then we decided we didn't want to do live streams. Didn't fit us.
Yeah.
So then our podcast series was already going. Yeah. So we decided that we should invest all our time and energy in our podcast series.
It was... So I was listening to it religiously I think it was actually after that party I told you about that I went to when I first heard
René Wise, everyone
like the whole lot. But I'd actually gone there because I was close friends, still friends with now, but not as close as we were at the time, with William Arcan, October, the French group, and they were playing there also. I think Teo wasn't playing, but you know, it was Arcan and October for sure. Went along with them, and then connected with Future Wes M for the first time. Gilles, the whole gang. Tom, whatever happened to her? It's like she was huge, right? And
It's hard for me to talk about it.
Okay.
Yeah, I miss her dearly.
Okay. I know I heard some things, but
she was
my
favorite.
Yeah.
Was my favorite. Yeah, I even wrote a concept for her called Pechera, which means cave in Ukrainian, and that is way before the war. The thing was when I joined Eerste Communie, it was like we should conquer Berlin. I said,
"You say conquer."
Yeah, conquer.
This word funny. Is great. It's yeah. great. Funny, especially right? if it came from Gilles, right?
No, 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 it didn't get no, no, no. Gilles would never do that. No,
with the hips to throw.
No, 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 no. Never. Desmond said it, but Desmond is also not really a raver.
Okay.
He is more...
He's more of a conqueror.
Yeah, more of a conqueror. That's why he said, let's conquer.
Very Dutch. I'm very Dutch.
Very Dutch. And he's from Suriname. But anyways, I said Kiev. Mm-hmm. And so when I was in Kiev, actually also to talk with the people from the club with no name, mm-hmm. Desmond called me and he said, actually, I really laughed when you said that. And look where you are. Yeah.
Has Desmond been there?
No.
No, not yet.
Only Gilles, me and Jesse. Oh.
Yeah. That's poetic.
Yeah.
I think he needs a tour.
He needs a tour. Yeah. Yeah.
Tell me, I'm just interested in the name. What stands behind the name of Eerste Communie?
So Eerste Communie is it's actually really simple. Mm-hmm. It's also on a Sunday. It's when you do your first communion, and it's where like-minded people come together. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the whole idea was that in that period, this particular sound. Techno died a bit. It was only the very commercial festivals.
Mm-hmm. Yes. 1617.
Yeah, 1617.
Yes.
And then the school was there.
Yes.
But, and we loved the school, but what we missed was consistency. Mm. So you would have...
With lineups.
So you would have four DJs, two were amazing, the other two were mediocre. Mm. And also how the whole buildup of a lineup, headliners on prime time, only woman opening, we were done. Mm. So that's why Eerste Communie happened. And also that's why we don't announce lineup.
Interesting. Cool. Yeah. Cool.
Although there is for sure a cookie cutter for Eerste Communie lineup. I mean, there is
it no, we play around with it. Because yeah. people say, oh, I know what was it? Winfrey is playing because he posted it. I said, yeah, they all posted it.
Yeah, I mean, after you build up a good, reliable brand and people can really rely on it's the same as the restaurant. You know you're getting a good dish. You don't want to know how it was made and you don't really want to know about the process behind it. You're going to find out.
Yeah. You
know? That sounds like a threat.
Hopefully not too late. Yeah. Yeah, you're going to find out. Yeah. Cool. Really interested. Haven't been to an Eerste Communie yet. Saw that there were some things happening in Berlin, I think, in the second of September. And there was already one event that happened Funkhaus, next to Funkhaus.
Yeah,
how was it for you?
It was amazing.
Yeah.
I heard amazing feedback.
Also heavy doing an event not in a club.
Yes,
that's very heavy. If you're not, if I would do it in Amsterdam, I have all my connections.
Yes,
and I know how to throw a party.
From scratch. Yeah.
But that was definitely really hard. And also, what was particularly hard for me was also that. But I think I have that in general, the collapsing of people.
Uh huh. Tell me more.
We all do drugs. I'm also very vocal that I use GHB. Always very vocal because I don't believe in demonizing a drug. Because that would mean no GHB, but then tons of speed and ketamine or other drugs. I do believe that GHB and GBL in Berlin are problematic because they are problematic. They were also very
just
problematic.
Just in Berlin?
Why are they problematic in Berlin?
No, it's also problematic in London. It's also very problematic. It was very problematic in Amsterdam. Mm. We see a change now in Amsterdam, though.
Why? Why is there a change? How is there a change?
Because we try not to demonize it.
Okay.
And talk about it. Mm-hmm. I would never advise someone young to start using this drug. Mm-hmm. Because I think it's a very dangerous drug. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, in ancient times, no, I'm just kidding. They used to even use crystal meth in Berkeley, you know, and you don't see that.
No, I have seen that.
You have seen
it? I have seen that in my time.
Yeah. I mean, they used to, they call it Tina or whatever, and it's not a trend anymore. And I'm asking myself, what happened there that made it uninteresting anymore for many? Or did the users just die? or
it's a very sustainable drug.
Okay, it's not sustainable.
No, and hard to party. Yeah. So if you get an addiction, you would do it at home with your friends.
Yes.
So many of
like heroin, for example.
Yeah, like heroin. Yeah.
Many of the people that I knew, because I used to take it regularly. I would say not excessively compared to many. I never collapsed in public or something like this. Mm. But I was taking it for most parties. I haven't for, well, this year at least. I don't plan to anymore, as I've realized that I just don't need it without still being an anecdote, you know.
Yeah.
I realized it was just excessive, you know, gratuitous. Many of the people who I know from COVID times and a little bit before COVID times, I mean, like say late 2019, who I knew were taking it regularly, the vast majority I'm still friends with don't touch it now at all.
Yeah.
Most of them are not kind of anti it. Like, yep. I don't want to be around people taking it because they understand it, but also don't feel the need for it for their experience now. Mm. And this includes DJs, party organizers, ravers. There are a few that still are. I have less and less contact kind of naturally, generally with like people in that scene, as I have noticed there is kind of like, so we rarely see anyone who's, let's say, obviously subjectively, you know, because yes. I know what it looks like if someone is taking a lot of this drug. But there's very few people at, for example, Drift or these smaller parties where it's like, yeah, so what you described is like if I see someone collapsing, that ruins my mood for the rest of the party. It, like, not just from a point of I'm worried about this person's health, but also the point of like, this is making me hyper aware that because this person's done that, and actually that person is clearly taking G, that person, is this gonna happen again? Do I have to be like more or
aware,
or,
yeah, alert,
and then just knowing that there's this kind of like, can I even say subculture? I definitely think there's a kind of layer of it.
And actually, I think at Eerste Communie, the majority of people collapsing were actually ketamine cases.
Oh yeah,
were a lot of ketamine cases.
Uh-huh. Or ketamine mixed with
Ketamine mixed with something else. I don't know. Yeah.
You said you were worried about collapses because it wasn't a club. In a club, it would be easier to manage.
Maybe in a club, it would be easier to manage. Also, we didn't have an awareness team.
Uh-huh.
Dangerous. So that is something that we would definitely do the next time.
Yeah.
Because we have a very strict door policy in Amsterdam.
Uh-huh.
And also we are, the community in Amsterdam, we look out for each other, especially the Eerste Communie community. We are really a family. So if something will happen, we are all there for you. Because an accident can happen. It's not about accidents. I believe accidents are allowed to happen.
Yeah.
But what I would do personally is have contact with the people after the party and talk to them, ask them if there's anything I can do for them. And if I see that someone has severe addiction problems, I probably ban them. And not because I don't want them there, but I don't want to be responsible.
Like, well, I mean, put it this way, like if you have someone who is collapsing from drug use pretty much every time they party, then and you've spoken to them and this is still the case,
if you
allow them into the party, you are then facilitating it.
Exactly.
And I've had this situation myself, as you know, I do selection, where I've had people who are friends of mine from the scene but I know that the awareness team has their hands full with them every fucking party. I know it. I've seen it every party. I know it. You know, I know as well. If you do that in here, this is not welcome. We don't want you to have so little either self-care or self-awareness or self-love that this is the result of you being in a space where you're allowed to take drugs. And if I've had a like the people that like who know that I'm not going to tolerate shit, you know, I just like, just actually sometimes respect it and say, actually, no, I'm not going to do that today. But it is a responsibility of an organizer to put your foot down, as you say, and have this stance when you feel that people are a risk to themselves or others.
Wouldn't it be interesting to try just not to facilitate it from the first time, just give this person another chance to stay a part of this party, a part of this community, but just not to use the specific drug or to give.
No, that won't work because you have your drug of choice.
Yes.
And if that's your drug of choice, the only thing is an accident can happen.
Mm-hmm.
Various reasons. It also depends how a person will react. When I talk to a person, mm-hmm. there was one case and this person was actually not really a big G user. And the way we communicated, it was not likely that it would happen again. So he was there the next time.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes you have cases that that are different. But I think I have a position now that people know who I am and they are very open. So I have a very honest communication with young people.
Mm-hmm.
Very honest.
Interesting.
I think it's if you're not having these tough conversations with people. So I know people that
because
have,
this is tough love.
Yeah. Well,
I love you, but I can't.
And actually, yeah. You know what? Like this kind of situation where you're like. Rejecting someone you care about, if they understand then why, I was actually, oh shit, maybe my actions that even I don't remember sometimes because I was so fucked, are really badly impacting my friends to the point where they don't want to be around me. Maybe this plants a seed that then leads to growth that, actually, do you know what, here's your second chance. But also, yeah, if you don't have this conversation and give a chance to change, then you haven't done your bit you haven't done the best you can.
Yeah.
But it becomes very toxic if you just, in my opinion, if you blindly let people in just because they're part of this network, when you know full well that their behavior is going to be very dangerous potentially or very toxic likely to people around.
And I have all the connections to, for example, we have Unity, which is a drug information center that's connected to Jelinek, which is drug prevention. So we have all the connections. A lot of promoters, I applaud them for that. For example, Pax Romana, they invite Unity to their parties.
Mm-hmm.
So young
they invite
people,
what, sorry?
The organization Unity, they provide information. Mm-hmm. You can even do drug tests there.
We have the same now in Berlin. Yeah. We have a couple of organizations that kind of are present at parties and
not as often as I feel they should be.
Yes,
I remember the old Greece Mueller always had them outside.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah,
but I think a lot of promoters are also scared. I think that's also
to officially say it's here, it exists. Yeah. Everybody
also
kind
at
Doich.
They had them at Doich as well in Remesa.
Yeah.
Shout to Nico and.
I think this reminds me of an urban legend in Berlin. A lot of people say that the big clubs here, when they have somebody collapsing, they just throw the person out of the door to die outside, so to say.
We've all heard that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you think about that? Do you think it's reality? Do you think it's really the fear of big organizations or the fear of promoters?
You see that some clubs change their interior.
Yeah.
And the interior is changed because it was too dark and you didn't even see when someone was dead in a corner.
Uh-huh.
Wow.
That sounds
yeah. And we all know people who work at clubs who I think in back in the days in Holland this would happen as well.
Mm-hmm.
And people were because you don't know what to do. It's a panic situation.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yes.
Yeah. And also in Holland you can lose your permit.
Well, I mean anywhere I guess. Yeah. I mean like any business, someone dies there. I think you have to fight to stay open for business.
I mean there is probably I would say a hole in the legislation that should allow promoters to deal with that responsibility.
Yeah.
If somebody in your party, which is responsible for his own body, her body or his body, is doing or having a mistake or an accident like that, like you say, the promoter should have the freedom to take responsibility and to help this person without taking into consideration the losing of a license or something, because it really can cost like human life.
Yeah, because medical wise, there was already something wrong with each beat's different because that's the only drug that makes you stop breathing.
Yes.
Even an overdose of ketamine doesn't do that.
Yes.
But I do think that's something that people don't realize. And of course, partying 3 days in a row, with no proper food, in a club, that's also something that we say in Holland. The moment Radion has a weekender, there needs to be proper food.
Yeah.
And I think the majority of clubs in Berlin don't provide proper food.
Most of them.
Yeah.
I always say that a pizza at 11 a.m. when everybody's jaws are locked, it doesn't make a lot of sense.
No.
You know, you need some smoothies.
You need some smoothies.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can't imagine ever ordering a pizza or any form of wheat.
A good soup welcome with to a lot Sisyphus. Of vegetables in it.
A fruit smoothie. I will grab one of those.
Yeah, whatever smoothie, you know, just get it into my body in a liquid form. And
I love a grilled cheese. Classic Ben.
The name of my second movie. Yeah. Yeah. Again, spin-off. We're coming back to Berlin's gastronomical mediocrity, which pisses me off. After years of raving, I just saw a good comparison. I have to bring up Kiev again. And once you see something good, we get used to something good very fast, you know. And the level of gastronomy there, the level of taking care of the guests there, even in terms of awareness team that appears from nowhere in a second and takes care of you and takes you to like a separate room and doesn't throw you away because the world outside could be even more cruel than the accident that you're having right now. Yeah, super interesting. Maybe we can come back through this topic from Eerste Communie and the risk of parties. Maybe we can come back to the night board and the challenges you're dealing there with. Because you probably communicate with governmental personas or bodies and so on and so on. How do they observe or look at the techno scene, the night scene? Are they tabooing or accepting? Are they acknowledging the use? Because I mean, Holland or Amsterdam especially is way more open for drug usage than probably Berlin and Germany in general. So, yeah, how is the communication?
No, nightlife. Nightlife is part, but I must say that the scene is not as big as in Berlin.
Yeah.
And nightlife.
It is very international though, which is something I can't say for the rest of the European scene
that's
that
true.
I've seen.
Yeah, mm-hmm. But I don't think that our urban scene is really big in Amsterdam. Mm-hmm. So it's nightlife in Amsterdam. It's not only techno.
Yeah.
Well, techno is maybe a small part.
Yes.
Of it.
It's more weed in pubs are probably like the biggest part of tourism.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yeah.
And yeah, I think nightlife is very important for Amsterdam. Although I think the freedom that Berlin has is bigger.
You do,
yeah.
In terms of
rules.
Rules, okay. Not only substances, or also maybe also sexual freedom.
There are a couple of clubs with 24-hour permits.
Uh huh.
Not every club has a 24-hour permit. Uh-huh. And how can you be alive if you compete with clubs that do have a 24-hour permit? Mm-hmm. That's very hard.
Is it hard for new places to come up in Amsterdam?
Also very hard, and also not only new places but also new places building wise. Mm-hmm. Because every the school is going to end in February.
Yeah,
Mark Cantina already ended last year, mm-hmm. but Radion is also temporarily. We only don't know when.
So the clubs in Amsterdam are facing the same, almost the same issues like in Berlin. Yeah. The Autobahn is going to be expanded in Berlin. Yeah. 5-6 clubs are going to close probably, which also makes them probably more popular because there's this constant feeling of closing down and people wanting to use the last.
I remember my first exposure to that was at the old Griesmuller, and it was always this urban legend that it's going to close one day. Every single, it's going to close end of this.
Like about Blank, for example. Also.
Yeah, true.
Which is still closing.
Yeah, and then,
already.
All of a sudden, it was just like, okay, January 2020, final Griesmuller. I was like, what the fuck? Well, no, January 2019.
2019, yeah. 2019, during Corona, they already started their assault. So.
Yeah, no. I remember like they did have a Griesmüller in exile for a bit, you know, where they looked for a new location.
I think. Yeah, yeah.
Also Polygon.
Polygon
Oxy. Also, yeah, yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that was the last kind of the old school sea noise I did was at Alta Munza in February 2020, the week before or the week after the last great Berghain for me, which was Freddie K's closing in
the last great Berghain.
Like what I mean by that, I mean you know how
it's your personal
you know how I feel about Berghain currently,
more or less, yeah.
To an extent,
you know how I feel about Berghain.
I also know it's slightly different. But
we all have love-hate relation with Berghain, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, for me, like, I've been to Berghain a couple of times since it reopened after COVID. Mm-hmm. Had great times both times, overall. But not even a glimmer of the magic I felt from... Okay, that's harsh. Not anywhere close. Not anywhere close to the magic I felt from... The last pre-COVID Berghain I did, which was Freddie K's closing in February 2020, and that was kind of the start of me questioning why I'm going. If I'm like, okay, well, that was great, but it's not what I was hoping for, and if I'm disappointed by going, why do I go when I know that I won't be disappointed by party XYZ, for example? Mm-hmm. And then, yeah, I guess. Well, that's my point.
Thank you, Rob.
I just did I have something to add there? I feel I had to qualify my last great Berghain. Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, there you are.
Something that I would like to refer to that we haven't touched yet. I think that there's a lot to talk about it. We could even devote a whole episode for that.
Yes.
We are in a nice scene, in a scene of electronic music where everything is kind of full of acceptance and open-mindedness, and everybody is equal, and from queer accepting to gender fluid. But how do you think everything looks right now as a female working in that scene? How far is this scene really from being ideal for a female? Because you are our first guest, you're the female mix that we needed in this cis male combination here.
Like, we haven't got much going for us in diversity. We're like, we can say we're queer as much as we want.
Yeah, exactly. We're as queer as a cis male can get. Yeah.
Fair.
Yeah.
But 99% confident. You know?
Yeah. yes, I really wanted to ask you how you feel working actively as a female in promoting and organizing, again in communicating with some political personas, in communicating with the people from night scene that see themselves as liberal and open-minded. Do you still feel challenged? Do you still feel that there are some glass ceilings that have to be broken, some misconceptions, or on the other hand, maybe reversed, we call it reverse racism, where you have to, there's this example of like bringing a female DJ because we need a female DJ. Yeah. So
we all know examples of that.
Yeah. I would.
No. We're very, 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 very far away from ideal. It is a struggle. It's a hard one. It's not this industry. The whole industry is still run by white, cis, heterosexual, middle-aged men. In techno, it's maybe like not that middle-aged.
Past their best.
But luckily, you see a lot of female DJs. You see a lot of queer, a lot of POC. But like you said, always check. If you are on a lineup, if it's not tokenism or pinkwashing or queerwashing, because I see that a lot. I believe in diversity, but I don't believe in diversity for every concept. Mm-hmm. Because if it is tokenism, please don't do it or pay me. If you double my fee, maybe I would consider. And then there is misogyny.
Excessive tokenism.
Yeah.
Nice.
And... sexual harassment, mm-hmm. crossing borders, which is also, it's really hard. I'm dealing in Amsterdam with a lot of cases where, because a predator is a predator. Mm-hmm. That's very obvious.
You mean they don't change or that?
No, it's that finally women are speaking up. Because people think it's a trend also that this is happening and that it's only in countries that, for example, I was in Poland, where it's logical that men are like that. But it's in Amsterdam exactly the same.
I was shocked.
And also in Berlin,
it's
the same. It's not any different. And it's even in Berghain, people touch my ass. So, and I think it's just normal heterosexual behavior is already very toxic for a woman. Just this normal behavior. I always give the example because my friends, my male friends, but I see that my woman friends, they don't say no. I said, do you know what it's for us to say no? No, I'm not going to give you my phone number. Oh, but why not? Do you have a boyfriend? No.
I don't want
no,
to.
No, but yeah, that's already three no's. So saying no is not the
having to answer an open question
no.
as to why not
exactly. So and also we are taught that when a woman says no, she actually means yes.
Yes,
that's what also I was taught that way. So it is almost impossible for us to say no. So we lie, or we walk away. Or we ask our friends to pretend to be our boyfriends.
And when you walk away, they follow. Hey, where are you going? Why are you doing it?
Yeah. I was pretty shocked when I firstly approached some promoters and some club owners with facts and things that happened and sex positive parties. And they told me, you know, that's how it goes, you know, for years. It has been since the punk scene. I mean, some people in Hollywood were rapists. Yeah. That doesn't mean that all of them should stay rapists today, you know?
It's for Radion team, because Radion is owned by white men.
They are super sweet. They are super sweet.
And
for a white man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And straight cis men.
Are they straight also?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
Even better.
Yeah.
Like to have this level of kindness, you know? Yeah.
And they're very, they listen. And for example, I had a case and then I said, but Wouter, do we want to keep on working with this promoter? And then Wouter said, yeah. And he said, do you know what? If you don't make the change, nothing is going to change. So now in contracts, we are going to have some rules in there to also educate promoters. And we talk to them. But like you said, this doesn't happen. And we love to swipe things under the rug.
Of course.
Because otherwise you get cancelled.
Nobody wants to risk a good name.
I'd rather be cancelled than that.
Yes.
And it's also really easy just to communicate. Because if it happens in your group, just be open about it. And do also something for women. And what my advice is, promoters out there, hire women. Take women in your team. Take queer people in your team.
Yeah.
Take people of color and not for tokenism. And pay them.
It changes the dynamic completely as well. It changes
completely.
The dynamic.
Just get another opinion, another point of view. Yeah. It's not even about mixing your
And even
staff.
Your friends.
Yeah.
Even your you can even have your girlfriend or your friends advise you on this. Because it's time and it's way overdue. But I'm done. Yeah.
Done with hiding.
Mm-hmm. I was never a person who would hide.
Yeah.
But I'm also here to support my sisters.
Nice.
So get ready for tough love from Izza.
Yeah.
whenever you see her coming.
Yeah. I will take a bullet, but I will shoot as well.
Small but deadly. Small but deadly.
Exactly.
Nice. Super nice. I think we're good.
Are we? Yeah. Okay.
I think we're exactly good.
Thank
you so much.
That's like super nice natural end. Yeah, Izza, that was wonderful. Really nice to get your input and
thank you for your energy.
Learn some new things about you and about About the scene and about these things that we've been discussing. It's nice to have.
We've probably touched only like the tips of icebergs and many topics. And I think speaking only not only for myself but for the team and Rob, we would love to do it again. Maybe we can do it also in Amsterdam.
I would love to. We would love to.
So if anyone has any questions or any feedback, opinions, it's an open forum, open discussion. Please don't be shy to comment on the video, and we'll be happy to interact in future whenever this this next happens.
And that's also what I wanted to say for all the females out there. If there's anything, please find me.
We had some questions at the beginning where we thought Rob and I will probably not be the qualified persons to answer or to give the right perspective.
Correct.
And we were waiting for a strong female figure to come in and enlighten us. So yes, again, thank you so much for being here, and hope
a shared honor.
Soon.
A shared natural namaste.
Natural namaste. Yeah. It's actually a high five. Yeah.
High five to me. Yes.
Nice.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you too.